in the room and welcome to our audience at home to the September 27th issue of the Zoning Board of Appeals. I'd like to start out with a roll call, please. Starting at my right, would you state your name?
My name is Steve LaPlante.
Jim Walsh.
Jay Chatmas.
Michael Trenfalia.
We have 4 of 7 sitting board members in attendance this evening. 2 board members have previously called in that they would be out of town, Lynn Galino and Joe Gugliometti. I received a call at 6:10 this evening, about 1 hour ago, from Gib Mendelson, that he had a possibly rather severe illness in the family and he was unable to attend this evening. We had indication earlier that he might be able to attend, but evidently the situation is not as we had hoped, or had he had hoped. Our thoughts are with him and his family, but he is unable to attend this evening. First item on the agenda is to approve the minutes of the June 28th meeting. Do I have any comments? Hearing none, may I have a motion to approve the minute?
So moved.
Seconded.
All those in favor? We'll withhold Stephen's vote. I think you were not at that meeting, is that correct?
Oh, that's correct.
So we have 3 in favor, minutes approved. First item on the business is on the agenda is old business to hear the administrative appeal of Paul Coulon, John Fatula, and Audrey Fatula for the code enforcement officer's issuance of a building permit. This is a well-known item on our agenda and has again been requested to be tabled for, my understanding, 1 additional meeting. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So we will continue to table that. I understand that the case is being resolved. If it has not been resolved already, we have 2 items of new business on the agenda. Both of these items are variances. According to the ordinance, the zoning ordinance, to approve a variance, we need 4 members of the sitting 7 board members to approve the variance. In normal situation, for all the other issues that we face, it's a simple majority of the number of members present. For a variance, we require 4. It's my understanding that Steve LaPlante is having to excuse himself from hearing the first case of Brian and Marianne Dennison. As of 6:10 this evening, prior to that, we thought we would have a quorum. As of 6:10, due to an illness, unexpected, we no longer have a quorum to vote on a variance, since the ordinance requires 4. If Steve LaPlante could vote, which he can't, we could hear your case of the Dennisons. But without his, and he's already requested in writing that he cannot, because of his proximity, cannot sit and vote. And so I find that most unfortunate. I'm sure it's extremely discouraging for you.
Yes, it's our second month.
It's truly discouraging for us, too, because it's our intention to assist and aid in passing a ruling on these according to the ordinance. It's out of our hands. We knew 2 members would be out of town for some time. We knew Steve could not vote for some time. We did not know about the illness until about an hour ago. All I can say is I'm disappointed for you, but our hands are tied. Bruce, do you have any comments?
I was just trying to figure out a way to make this work. As chair, since we have held this meeting, you could pick a date certain for next week, because this meeting was advertised and the people who are interested in this case are here tonight, you could pick a date without having to go through the advertising process through the paper again, and you could pick a date probably for next week. The problem with that is getting everybody together, or at least one more member together, next week. But, you know, that's, you do have the right as chair to do that.
I'd be happy to do that. I don't know if this works for the applicants, or I know they need a determination. And I understand that.
At least you wouldn't have to wait another month, you know.
I mean, as you know, the winter months are coming, that's...
If you don't mind, could you come to the, so that everybody has the opportunity to hear your comments? We'd appreciate hearing your comments.
Well, the only problem is the winter months are coming, so we're getting limited to building. And that's where we are. I mean, this was July, we'd probably have no problem, but we're getting to colder months, so...
Sure.
And we were ready last month, and there was no quorum, and now we're here again tonight and find out there's no quorum. So, as you stated, it is very frustrating for us because we have a builder ready to go.
And I received a call at home. I mean,
I understand
the town offices obviously were closed, and so that being as it is, it's an unfortunate situation for everybody involved. Do you have comments? This would be a special meeting, is that correct?
Yeah, I'm in full agreement that we should call a special meeting next week. And I'm open every night, so, I mean, I think that we owe it to these citizens to give them a decision so that they can get forward with their... If they're going to build, fine. If they're not going to build, they'll at least have a decision.
Right.
And winter conditions are going to cost them money as well if they have to pour a foundation with at that time. So I'm all in favor of going forward with the special meeting.
Steve?
I completely agree. I think it's an important piece of business that needs to be conducted.
Okay. You need a ruling one way or another. Bruce, we need to... I'm sure we have to go through certain protocol of determining room availability and other issues. How should we handle it from here?
Well, the only way you can make it work is you have to come up with a date tonight.
When do we know when?
We'll worry about it if we can't. You know, I don't know what the schedule is.
Do you know if this room's available or when?
See, I could have found that out had I known earlier.
Can we tentatively?
The planning board meets Tuesday, so maybe.
How about the fellow that's running the camera tonight? Doesn't he have a schedule on the wall in there as to what's taking place?
He's listening.
Maybe he can come out and help us on that one, because he's probably got a schedule. Does it have to be televised?
It's got to be recorded.
The only meeting that I'm aware of is next Tuesday.
Tuesday.
That's what I thought.
All right, so in that case, then the chairman has... Great. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
We figured somebody did. Thank you.
We could declare Monday and see if that works.
Yeah.
I don't think Monday's a busy meeting type. I know you travel. Is that
Monday, October 3rd, 7 o'clock?
Yeah.
I will not be here. I'm in Massachusetts all week, but you
okay, what day?
Can't survive without me.
We would like for you to be in attendance.
I can't be in next week. I'm in Massachusetts all week.
All week.
At college, school, Hold College. So
it's my personal feeling that you should be here and be involved. That would delay it another week. I would think as a...
Under the circumstances, I can probably direct you by putting some kind of a demo together on the issues that I see.
Okay.
And I think you could probably take it from there.
Okay. If
I hate to postpone it more than a week.
But if I understand, if you're not in town, then there'll be nobody available to review the building permit application. Is that correct? If you're the only one that can issue it.
I can look at it. Well, if you haven't submitted the building permit yet.
We're waiting for this piece.
Well, I mean, if you got the building permit in ahead of time, if you want to apply for it, or just drop off the paperwork, I can look at it and make a determination whether I can, or that would be issued on Tuesday if we need to get going on Tuesday.
Okay.
We can work that out.
Okay, thank you.
So what did?
I can work it out. If it's approval Monday night, I can work that out between now and Monday to have that a go for Tuesday if that need, that's what happens.
Okay. So, meeting next Monday?
It's fine.
Can I just go on record that our neighbor is here tonight, and I'm not sure if he's available Monday night or not?
Well, we hope he is.
Okay.
So if that time is agreeable with you and other board members, Monday at 7 o'clock here?
Well, you can only speak for who's here.
We need another board member, so at what point will we know that there's going to be a quorum Monday night?
We do not know that at this time, but we will certainly confirm, and we have a full week to do that. And we will certainly confirm, and if that date does not work out, then we will certainly notify you and suggest alternative dates.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And again, we are making, I think, extraordinary concessions on this by rescheduling it because the applicants have been delayed one time previously. And because of that, we're trying to assist in any way we can. So I'd like that to be known for the record.
Thank you.
That this is a second delay is the reason we're doing this. Thank you again. The second item on the agenda is to hear the request of Ariette McDonald, 36 Trundy Road, tax map U12, lot 38, for front variance, overlook lane property line variance, a front property line variance, overlook lane, of 10 feet from the required 25 feet, and a side, west side property line variance of 15 feet from the required 25 feet. To construct an addition and add a second story over the existing structure. One thing Ms. McDonald? Thank you. One thing I'd like to point out before we do start here is that, as I mentioned earlier, and this is very relevant to you, is for a variance, we require four members to have a quorum, we require four members to be present, of which there are, and we can all vote on your case. To approve a variance, we require four of the seven board members. In other situations, we require a simple majority. If this was a non-variance issue, three out of these four could vote for and approve the request. Since this is a variance, we require four of seven, and since there are only four here, all four members must vote in the affirmative. That becomes relevant because in some situations it's difficult to have four out of four, not due to you, but due to the process and the items that we review. So all four of us must vote in the affirmative. We do give you the option to postpone to a later date in hopes, in anticipation that there's a full sitting board present, and in which case there are four of seven need to vote in the affirmative instead of four out of four today. We do always provide applicants with the option to delay with that in mind. Hearing that, we would like your comments on whether you want to proceed or to delay, postpone. Before you say anything, if you'll come to the board, to the podium.
Okay, and I'll just, as I'm doing so, introduce my new husband. We
Mark Higgins.
You're both welcome. Thank you. If you'd like to discuss it a moment.
Well, that's what I was, that was the first thing I was going to say. Could we just quickly discuss it amongst ourselves?
I've got a question, too.
I'm sorry?
You want to recess?
Yeah, we can recess for a few moments.
I have a question.
Yes.
We did get declined this evening in a situation like this where everybody is not present. Would we be able to revisit it a month from now, or would this be a binding final decision?
I think what the ordinance says is you couldn't revisit it for a year or something like similar application. No.
So we're faced with the same situation, winter construction and so on. Did you want to discuss it?
So they cannot postpone their...
Let me look it up while it recess.
And yeah, we'll take a moment to talk.
Thank you. We'll recess for 5 minutes, please. First, I want to comment, let me comment first, and then we'll listen to your comment, just for clarification. because of what I explained earlier, only four board members present, you can elect to table your application for this meeting, present the application at the next meeting, which will be the October meeting, and we will be happy to hear it at that time, assuming there'll be more board members present. That would be the benefit. If you, regarding your question to Mr. Smith, if you ask us to vote on it tonight, and it is denied tonight, you cannot bring back a new application for 1 year. We'd be happy to table it for 1 month, but if we proceed, then it's the 1 year before you can reapply if it's denied.
Mm-hmm. We both discussed it, and we feel comfortable going through the process with the quorum that is here this evening and
okay.
Working
so you
with
proceed with that.
Yes.
Okay.
It'd be a little nicer if you had a plasma screen TV with the Red Sox on. That would make it go.
Priorities are important. I noticed the audience dipped them out. All right. If you would kindly introduce yourself, state your current address, and make your presentation.
Mm-hmm. My name is Ariette Higgins now. At the time of the application, it was Ariette McDonald. And I live at 3 Pine Point Road, Cape Elizabeth, and have purchased 36 Trundy Road, Cape Elizabeth, and would like to create a renovation on the
if
house.
You would summarize your application,
oh,
your intention,
okay.
And go over your plans for the benefit of us and the audience here.
Yeah. What we would like to do is alter the existing 1950s ranch-style roof lines of the house to become a 12-12 pitch, which some people will refer to as a Cape Cod pitch, I believe, and thus acquire space under those roof lines to add to the living space of the house. Between us, we actually have 6 children, and there are 3 bedrooms in the house right now, so one of the major goals is to add a 4th bedroom and additional bathroom, as well as some additional living space. Is that complete enough for you? Oh, and what our proposal basically goes over the existing footprint of the house as it is laid out right now. It just goes up a total of 8 feet at the highest point, but the existing footprint doesn't meet current setback requirements, so here we are.
The way I understand it is that your existing house extends into the left side, westerly side. Your address is Trundy, left side setback and the rear setback. You want to build up on the existing footprint.
Mm-hmm.
You want to make an addition to the front and east side,
mm-hmm.
which would be in the non-setback or the building envelope area,
mm-hmm.
in addition to that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We'll open the, if there are any board members that have questions in regard to this.
Harriet, I'm very familiar with this particular piece of property. I looked at it myself.
Oh, how about that?
Yeah. The private way across the back side of the property, that private road, that you're removing the dog fence, I believe, according
mm-hmm.
to what you've said here, and removing the porch.
Mm-hmm.
Are you going to have any access for parking or automobiles or anything with that private way to your property?
No. Actually, we have extraordinarily generous neighbors who recognize that we are on a fairly steep incline and that our driveway in the winter might not be the easiest to navigate. They've actually offered their driveway spaces to us since they're summer residents.
Mm-hmm.
So we personally don't have any
There's no plan for you...
Plan for that.
To add a parking area down near the porch area or whatever?
Mm-mm. Just landscaped, you know, grass.
Okay. And is that addition in the front where the current single-car garage is located, and that will be moved to a two-car garage, is that bump out there absolutely essential to this remodel?
No, it's not central, but it was the garage does happen to be a heated garage, and trying to find some of that mudroom space that can become so essential when you have children in Maine with snow season and mud season and whatnot, we thought could be a practical thing to find in the back of the garage, but the garage is pretty shallow. So that was the practical consideration. The aesthetic consideration, if you look at the proposed elevation of the front of the new house, was that facade can feel somewhat stark aesthetically, and that we've been trying to create what looks like an antique structure, and that was a common way for a garage or shed to be built. There's one actually on Wells Road going on down to Sawyer. I believe it's the Miss Van Wy's house where the garage area is built into the hill and it bumps out like that. It becomes a historical aesthetic, and it also softens the facade.
Sure.
So it was and that's indicative of everything we did, everything that was thinking of both the aesthetics as well as the practical needs.
Okay. Are you going to remove any of that pavement in that front?
We would really hope to. This is going to be an expensive project, and any landscaping shifts are going to have to wait till another day of saving
sure.
up a few more dollars to approach, because that is a very overwhelming expanse of asphalt.
It certainly is. Yeah, there's no question about that. I was
yeah.
just curious if that was in the plans. And then where you're bringing the corner of your porch, you're asking for a variance, obviously, to bring that corner point to closer to the lot line. How close are you to the greenhouse that exists on the property next to you?
Oh,
it doesn't show on this plan. I was curious if you could help us with that.
Are you looking at this one?
Well, if we look at this this large map that you've provided,
yeah.
this one, the greenhouse is located. Right. Okay. And that's not on your property at this point, is it? That fence? It is, okay.
But I believe that this porch actually sits within the green box of setback.
Okay. All right, interesting. Good. Okay, thank you.
Right, if I may, you know the current, the height of the house currently? Oh, what the proposed total height of the addition will be. I know it's going to be 8 feet. But
right. I know that's going to be an additional 8 feet, and I could take that for you with a ruler off of the, because it's a quarter inch to a foot scale off the existing elevation. But of course, I don't have a ruler. Does anybody here have one? Or?
Well, the reason for my question is it needs to be under 35 feet.
Yeah.
No issue there.
It's, my best guess would be 10, 20, 23 feet tall right now. At the most, that'd be an overestimate, maybe 22.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the other point is that if you you indicate in your application that the current setback requirements are different from when this house was built originally,
mm-hmm.
and you've outlined that in the green, in that
those are
grid.
The current, yep.
So the issues we're identifying today, or issues we have, are to allow you to do this work, we have to give you a variance for these two pieces that are effectively outside of the setbacks.
Mm-hmm. Those two pie-shaped corners, triangular-shaped corners, and that would be areas of the proposal where we're working with the existing footprint.
That's what I want to make sure of as well. What you're asking for is already the building's is an existing footprint.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. At the end of, I believe it's section two, you have a comparison data in spreadsheet format. Would you spend a little bit of time on that, please?
Sure. And I also speak to it in the explanation letter that I, sorry, I just have to find it. Okay. In the proposal letter. History of Overlook Lane was very fascinating to me as I looked into it, and neighbors helped me understand it, because at one point it had been, for all those neighbors that have properties with Overlook addresses, they all had properties that was their rear entrances. It was a service entrance for them, and there was a road that's since been vacated in the front of their properties, I believe called Bayview Road. So there's been an interesting evolving history, but basically what exists now is this hill that, you know, crossed basically pretty much with my house, I think, and the Kellys behind it, and kind of tapers off to the sides and creates a little cluster of houses all sitting together at the top of this hill. So I looked at those houses and found that each one of them seem to present anomalies with the current setback requirements, because they were finding the best siting that they could, given the topography that they had for their particular lot, and where there were deep depressions and where there were steep rises and whatnot. So the data had no rhyme or reason in a way, but that seemed that was the consistency, is that everybody was trying to find a placement on the lot that worked with the topography before a hill would drop off or whatnot, and thus it caused some people to be too close to the front, some too close to the back, some too close to the side, et cetera, et cetera. There's also a long history of those parcels of land, I don't completely understand it myself, being owned by, you know, first one person, then two people, and then it gradually sectioning off bit by bit by bit, and that seemed to cause some of the anomalies as well. If somebody owned three or four parcels, they sited their houses ages ago in a different way, and their supporting structures as well. I don't know if that helps at all or makes it more confusing.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. That I want to clarify with Mr. Smith first, and then I'll address to you. In their situation, they have a Trundy Street address, and that is the front of their house. They also have Overlook, which is on the other side of their house. In a normal situation, the back setback is reduced to 20 feet. In this situation, where they have a road on both the front and the back, is the back continue to be 20 feet? As far as setback, building envelope,
there would be, for zoning setback purposes, there would be no rear setback. There'd be two front setbacks and two sides.
So it'd be 25 on all four sides, then.
Correct.
So in their unique situation, they do not have the opportunity of a 20-foot rear setback. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. Or from the street, from an active street?
That's correct.
I noticed on your plot plan that your rear setback, or your green hatched line, dotted line, is indeed 20 feet.
Mm-hmm. It is.
In a normal situation, this would be correct.
Mm-hmm.
The purpose of that ordinance is, or the, and this is my interpretation, that is that the intent of the ordinance was to keep the house a greater distance from an active street, assuming that a backyard was not the rear of the house, and typically, and I would assume probably in most cases in our community, there's no street on the back of a house, no active street, no recognized street. And so they reduced the ordinance, reduced with that in mind, reduced that setback from the typical 25 feet to 20 feet, keeping the two sides between neighbors at 25 feet and off of the active street in front of 25 feet. In your situation, for good or for bad, you have two active streets. So it appears to me that would cause a bit more, 5 more feet of encroachment on the rear of the property. Do you understand that?
I understand what you're explaining.
Yes, you're correct. But in the bigger picture, it really makes no difference because you're still comparing to the neighborhood.
Okay.
So from that respect, from that perspective, it really doesn't make
it doesn't matter. It's just that it's still encroaching, whether it's
right.
Your rear encroaches,
right,
whether it's 5 feet,
right,
or less. I wanted to bring that point,
right,
out.
It is more of the picture, I think, too, that describes why we're here, which is how difficult it is to work with this piece of property, its topography, and how it's complying with today's needs.
I think you're... Two comments. First of all, when you submitted your letter, you referred to your fiance. I wanted to congratulate you.
Thank you
very
much.
A recent event. The second, your packet that you put together was quite comprehensive, and we do appreciate that. It's good to have this information.
You're welcome.
One of the items that we look at and that we vote on is item number 4, the granting of variance will not produce an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood. Under the definitions of our ordinance, for clarification, undesirable change in the neighborhood, the result of a variance where the structure is larger or closer to the road or property line than the average of the nearest 10 fenceable structures, or in the case of variance requests for an accessory structure, the nearest 10 accessory structures, that doesn't apply to you. And you have certainly supplied that information. You gave 10 of the nearest properties and outlined them quite well and included an 11th property. It's my understanding that out of the 11 that you presented, that 6 of those 11, you do meet the current square footage requirement, being that yours is in character. Your addition will not create an overly out-of-place house in the neighborhood, and that's the intention of that.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at the side, front, and rear setbacks, and for the case of our situation, we will call the front and we'll look at the front and rear as one and the same. We won't
mm-hmm.
distinguish the front from the rear. Mm-hmm. Since you have a road on both sides, we'll call both the front and the rear. We'll look at both as a front setback.
Okay.
And the variation. On the side setback, there are 8 associated properties that meet that you in the neighborhood of the 10 nearest property that also encroach on the side setback. So 8 out of the 11 do. So you certainly mm-hmm. meet it in that category. On the front or rear setbacks, you have 2 front and 2 rear for a total of 4. That becomes a bit of an issue. And because of that, have you, and I'm sure you are aware of this fact of the front and the rear, have you looked at in part of your extensive design, have you considered not encroaching upon that rear setback? Is that a possibility?
We have tried to consider that and hope that we can come up with a design solution that works aesthetically for the exterior of the house. I believe that we will be able to find a way to make the inside work. We will be able to acquire the square footage we're looking for.
Be able to what? I'm sorry.
I believe we will be able to acquire the square footage that we're looking for and work with that rear corner problem because it is so small.
Okay.
My concern is the aesthetic balance of the house on the exterior. Because my neighbors, it's one of their nearest views. It's my hope that it's going to be a pleasing, charming view for them as well, and isn't something that looks kind of lopsided or imbalanced. Again, that trying to be faithful. And I use the Kellys as my example, who are directly behind us. There's a picture of their property in the application folder. Their house is actually a reproduction of the house that was once there, but you can't tell. It was such a faithful reproduction that you can't tell if it's the original house, lovingly cared for. And I hope that our house will look as balanced in proportion as antique homes do without, those kinds of problems. One of the question marks that I do have in discussing the front and rear setbacks for you is that in inquiring at the code enforcement office, my understanding was that my front setback requirement was 30 feet, 30, 20, and 25. And I actually had Lori look that up for me once too.
The district setback is 30 feet for a conforming lot.
Yeah.
Non-conforming lot, the setback is 25.
Okay, because that was the figure I'd been given, and so that's why I presented the facts the way I did. So I guess that helps me understand that glitch in there.
I think that makes a lot of difference, though, as far as, if the crux of the application is based on like situations, it really makes no difference whether it's 30 feet or 25 feet.
Except it would increase the understanding of it being 30 feet would increase how many other neighbors didn't comply with the front setback. And I did think that it was 30 feet. Yeah. I think
I know
that
we had long discussions, but evidently that question had been answered through the book, and because I don't think we discussed that, but.
Yeah, I just got the figures read off to me twice, so I did double check.
In the book, if you go into the district, it says what it says is it's 30 feet, except that developed nonconforming lots, you have to go back to the nonconformance section, which is 19.43A2.
Yeah.
And that's where the 25 feet is.
Yeah. So
it's not in the district standards, it's in the nonconformance section, so that can be confusing.
Yeah, so unfortunately that was a glitch. I guess what I would ask, if I could, for your consideration, if it's a possibility, is the fact that the possibility of requesting a variance exists because there are certain situations where because of pre-existing structures and whatnot, houses and neighborhoods can't fit into the current requirements. And so a structure supports understanding their particular set of anomalies. And one of the examples I saw was Sawyer Road, how at one time, because of the nature of the road, people met requirements, but all in a row, all of a sudden, now they don't have the same, they all don't have the same front setbacks. The nature of this neighborhood doesn't fit into a pattern that can even be defined into a structure. I compare it more to like the cluster around Peebles Cove or the cluster at the very tip of Hannaford Cove Road, where there's this kind of very randomness to the way structures sprung up, so it is very hard to show you within a defined structure that we're all doing a similar thing. in the neighborhood. And I guess one of the things I love about that clustering, another person would come and say, oh my goodness, I could never live with my neighbors in my laps like this, and in my lap like this. But many people find to be the intrinsic charm of that type of...
We understand exactly what you're saying, and so does the ordinance, and that's why they give us the liberty to, if a majority of the homes in the neighborhood are in the situation that you described, then we can assume that that's not creating your changes, your requests are not creating an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly why the ordinance is written the way it is. Mm-hmm. Back to your non-conforming situation, question. Mm-hmm. That's an academic ruling, and I would assume that almost all the lots in Shore Acres are non-conforming. Mm-hmm. Because the new ordinance requires 88,000 square feet for a house in the residential A, and I believe this
80,000. Yeah.
80,000. And the only place you see that is in Stone. You know what I'm calling Stonegate.
Stonegate.
I knew it was Stone something. Stonegate.
Rock Restaurant.
And Elizabeth Farms in that area, like that, where there are much larger lots. So all the lots are non-conforming, and that's not an issue. You just deal with it and move on, and but that's why the setbacks are what they are. You are requiring a bit of an unusual variance, because you're actually requesting two different variances. You're requesting a side setback variance and a rear front. They're one and the same in your situation. Rear setback variance. So you're lumping two together. And because of the way the ordinance was written, and our need to justify your request as not being unusual for the neighborhood, then the board will discuss this, but on first pass, your square footage meets that, and it's agreeable with the neighborhood houses of that size. So the square footage isn't an issue. The side setback appears not to be an issue. That's one variant. So square footage and size in first pass seems to meet this particular requirement. There are other elements to this that we'll deal with. The size and the rear setback appears not to be, and that's why I was requesting whether you had addressed that issue. Now, we don't want you to have to, you know, cripple your house to meet the ordinance, but
right.
The ordinance is written for a reason, and we have to interpret it, and I don't want that to, if you say that, you know, only the, you know, I want both or none, and then that's a potential problem that we and you are going to have to face. So I want you to be aware of that, and that's why I ask, could the design, and it seems a much smaller area on the rear, but nevertheless, an inch an inch is a variance. Whether it's a small or not is irrelevant at this time.
Right.
But from a design standpoint, it appears to be smaller. Is that a potential?
That would be an area that I would be flexible about your feedback. It wouldn't make or break our request. It would be my preference, obviously, or first choice. Again, not so much for our livability of the house or even the view of the house that we enjoy, but for the sake of the neighbors who really are oriented so that I hope that I can honor what I consider my obligation to them to create an aesthetically pleasing structure and garden and add... be an asset to them as a neighbor. That's all.
I just want you to understand our situation.
Absolutely.
We are obligated to interpret to your benefit as much as we can, but we have to interpret the ordinance, and so you do need to be aware of that.
Did you want to say something, Mark?
We did. We were very concerned about the neighbors, and we did go around to the 10 closest neighbors with the house plans, and we got the opportunity to discuss it with several of the neighbors, most importantly, the ones that would directly be impacted. The Kellys right behind us. And
the Madigans on the side.
The Madigans, and they were very favorable in regards to us doing this, in that it would improve certainly the architectural appeal of the home, and it would be consistent with what's been done in the neighborhood. But we were concerned, and we didn't want to do anything that would be negative upon the neighbor. So we were happy to be well received. And as far as what we're speaking about, the rear variance, we respect what you have to do and looking at that. It is more architecturally pleasing if we were able to get the rear variance as well, because of the side views that some of the neighbors will see. The dormer will look a little blunted and so on, but we could live either way with it, but it would be a more pleasing, much more pleasing if it were allowed that few extra feet.
Yeah, and the way the house is angled into the corner on a diagonal, it what ends up being the view of several of the neighbors is that sort of back side, not the back, not the front, but it's kind of that back, well, right. That's why it's the piece of pie, because of the way it's sticking out like that. So that we're just trying to be respectful of that.
No, and I understand that. I just wanted you to be aware that because of your application, we have to look at it in two parts, but we'll
sure.
approve it as one. And
you feel you need to eliminate that one part in order to approve the other parts, is that a possibility? If you felt you were able to approve the two parts, the size increase and the side variance request, could you eliminate the rear variance request and approve the other two parts? Is that what you were?
Jay,
okay,
just
I just want to make
for
sure.
Conversation piece. That corner already exists.
That's true.
Doesn't it?
Yeah. That's correct. But they're adding a second floor onto it.
So you're adding.
Well, actually, at that point, what would be added in that corner would be the junction of the roofing. If the wall would be higher, it would be the junction, and it would be the slope going up to
yeah, if you look at that pitch, you've got the back side of that house design.
And in doing this, the 50s roof lines, they actually jut out, I think, about 20 inches or so. Those
it's
this area,
it's this
here.
Corner right here that we're talking about.
Yeah, it's this corner right here, and this all exists.
Yeah,
this all exists. This is the corner that we're discussing.
Yeah, I'd be inclined to agree with their the applicant's drawings, that they've actually considered the neighborhood more so by adding this way. They're simply continuing up upon an existing structure.
The ordinance says there can be no expansion in that setback area. Am I correct, Ruth?
Yeah,
what was the comment?
The ordinance states that there can be no expansion in that setback area.
Yeah, an upward expansion or an outward expansion.
Upward or outward.
Even though you're not going closer, it's still expansion. It's not allowed without a variance.
But it's this view in particular that we're the north elevation. Thank you for letting me look at yours, because I knew where it was right away. The north elevation, this corner and this whole side just really faces the Kellys and the two properties owned by the Meadows. And this corner. This is the discussed corner aesthetic.
And that second floor addition for you, Harriet, gets you views, water views.
Actually, not in that corner, because what we did was we went to the Kellys and we checked to see what their views were.
Yep.
And we were going to place these windows very high up.
Yep.
so that we wouldn't have to mask them. They would probably be in the bathroom, and light would just come in,
sure.
And they couldn't see in, and we couldn't see out.
Because you have those huge trees next to the Kellys anyway, I think. There's
yeah.
a huge group of trees
and,
there.
Yeah. yeah, and the place where I think we achieve water use is the place where you don't need to discuss with you about the parents.
Yeah.
It should be the front of our new bed.
Yeah, okay.
Probably the previous page. But actually, the whole house gets seasonal glimpses. It would be
yeah,
these
yeah.
windows we
yeah.
would be lucky to achieve and these as well.
Yeah. But the issue with the literal interpretation of that variance says that you can't do that in the existing footprint. Is that true?
Correct.
Yeah. So that's the key element here.
Mm-hmm.
And if we look at it in reference to how she's tried to be consistent with the neighborhood and cognizant of the neighbors and all the other elements,
mm-hmm.
I think that's the weight that we have to use in our judgment on one of the elements.
Can you point out which corner it is?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Please.
Because it's really...
I know, it's so confusing.
This is the west elevation.
Yes. This is the rear view of the house, and this is the corner of the house that that's the issue that each of the houses are very discussing. And this part of this eye faces, and this part is the altar.
And this is
virtually don't come to this corner.
Existing second floor?
No.
Existing one first floor, but it's the
existing first floor, and then the room line now is the 12th here, and probably about
6 feet
at the peak. And then this is another representation that we can make sure I'm telling you the right thing as it tells you this. That's the
rear
corner. Right there.
Thank you very much.
Uh-huh.
Now, one of the options not to build in that corner would be to set a slider or something or a deck, a small deck, back from the corner into that new 12. I mean, that's one of the options architecturally that could be done so as to not encroach.
Right.
We actually explored that. We thought that would be a great option. We were afraid that that wouldn't meet requirements also because that's technically living space, and
yep.
we thought that we would be in a fuzzy area too, so we should just present the whole thing to you
sure.
And talk about what was
yep.
possible. Though, you know, I didn't specifically discuss that with you, Bruce, so I don't know, but it would add, in effect, an outdoor living area upstairs. I don't know how that criteria would be evaluated.
Well, any increase in square footage.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's a problem.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah, and it's hard because then when I go to compare for you, I can only really support give you figures that I know are absolutely true and conservative. So I use the tax assessor square footage. So I don't even give you enclosed screen porches in my figures and that type of thing. I only give you dead on, inside, interior living space, not even basement space. So actually all those figures are a little underestimated probably in terms of the sizes of the houses. But it still showed that we were in line with them, so I left it in the conservative place.
Explain that again, please.
In terms of presenting you my square footage figures, I erred on the side of being very conservative with them. I talked to the tax assessor, and I went by the figures that he uses for living space, and he doesn't include outdoor decks or patios and sometimes screened-in porches and basement spaces and whatnot. So I erred towards the conservative, lesser side the way he does.
Living space.
Hmm?
The living space.
Yes.
Right. But there's no issue there anyways.
No, there's no issue.
There's no issue there. And
again, there's no issue with the side setback,
right.
but the issue is that just because you meet the side setback, that doesn't give you carte blanche for the other two sides,
sure.
two or other three sides. You met that requirement, so those three are okay to encroach upon too.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to look at, and traditionally we have looked at the left side compared to the left side, but side setbacks is what we look at, and front setbacks, and in your case, front and rear is one and the same, which is in your benefit,
mm-hmm.
of course, since you do have a street.
Yeah.
on both sides?
Well, yes and no.
Yes and no.
Loses two because it's not 30, so. Well, that wouldn't make any difference on the rear, would it?
It's just, you know, it's one of those crazy things. Everybody's lot presents them with a different topography. They have to site where they site, and sometimes it's like in the instance of that greenhouse, which is just, I love it. I love the fact that it's sitting right adjacent to my property line, but it's like 2.5 feet away because that's where it fit, you know, in the hillside, so.
And the ordinance supports that very thing.
Yeah, I understand.
Which is
I'm just saying that, you know, it's just these finding those flat places created random anomalies. And that's the consistency, is that the anomalies are random, I guess.
Any other questions?
I have a question about, I like your application. I have never seen sending out statements to neighbors and having them mail them to the.
Well, you know, again, I was trying to like respectfully give them a chance to do it in their own time without putting pressure on them, but allow you to have the information. So I hope that worked.
It did. I only have I'm making an assumption. I just wanted to, going back to one of the elements of granting a variance is the undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood will not unreasonably or detrimentally affect the use and market value of abutting properties. And some of the elements that determine that would be whether or not you'd be eliminating any privacy of adjoining property, reducing the appraised value of adjoining property by more than 10%, casting a shadow on an adjoining lot, posing a fire safety hazard, or blocking an established view. And just driving by the property, it looks to me that the property directly to your left, the Mayberries, potentially might have the biggest impact on a view channel. And interestingly enough, what I wanted to comment about your forms is you only gave people one choice. Now I'm in support of the proposed.
Well,
so I assume that either the other eight people are against it or they were indifferent. But the two that we returned are obviously in favor, and the one that did, one of them, I think most importantly, is your most adjacent neighbor who I think would have the biggest impact in terms of view. So.
Oh, so who were the two that returned it?
Mayberry and Sells.
So. Oh, okay, great. That's great. Yeah, well, and the neighbors have been really open to conversing about it, which has been wonderful, and even inviting us into their homes, and please can you go up to that window and make sure where your sight lines are, and they've been really great.
That house is above your house, though, is it not?
Madigan's, yeah, and his view corridor, he just said.
And he's also got the third floor of that.
He said, there's no way you can block it, that view's fine, don't worry. And then Kelly's, they look out over the cove in the other direction, and I think that the house that we have was sited so that the Kelly's still had a corridor straight between the lawn and the greenhouse as well, because they have views there, but we hope that we've determined that nobody's going to be adversely affected that way.
We can assume that since they're not here and an objection, that they're.
It's a good assumption.
Yeah.
That they're watching the ball game, I guess.
Yeah.
That it's not an issue for them. Any other comments, questions? Thank you very much. We may call you back if we have any further questions.
You're welcome, and thank you. Do we just sit down and wait? Do we go away?
No, you please have a seat.
Okay.
Thank you. Please have a seat. Don't leave. Seeing no other members in the audience, I assume that there is no one to speak in favor or opposed to the application. I assume I'm correct. The Denisons are not here to comment on that. But. So we will close the meeting to public comment and open it for discussion with the board members.
Jay, I just want to compliment the applicant on the completeness of this application. I'd like to see all of these details when we're trying to consider a situation, especially you know, the work that's gone into this has been very helpful from my perspective. I have a question for Bruce, however, is that, is this a sort of all or nothing sort of situation? Is there a way to, I see that the bump out at the garage level requires a variance, and also the second floor, both on the right-hand or left-hand side of the house, depending upon what you look at it. There's three pieces to this, it appears, from my perspective. Is it an all or nothing situation?
No. It's advertised for what was submitted, mm-hmm. but as long as whatever's approved mm-hmm. is not, doesn't take it out of the realm of the advertisement, then yeah, you can make modifications. Mm-hmm. You can approve part of it or all of it, or you could vice versa deny all or part of it.
Okay.
I have a question also to you, Mr. Smith, regarding on the application percentage of the lot currently covered by structures. That is purely a building footprint question. Is that correct? That does not count impervious.
No, purely building footprint.
And they state a 3.4% increase, and that's based, I assume, primarily on the porch and the front of the garage.
And the reason why I ask that, because there is a 20 and 25% maximum coverage, depending right. on whether you're on sewer or septic, so. Mm-hmm.
But that does not include, that is purely looking at dwelling footprint, correct?
Structures, all structures. Accessory sheds, pools, anything that occupies space.
Mike, I think your comments earlier were proper regarding, I'm speaking about the rear increase now, that it is minimal. But from our standpoint, and Mr. Smith echoed it, or confirmed it earlier, an increase is an increase, and we have to look at it as an increase. Yeah. And that is my concern, is that the square footage is not an increase, is not an issue, the side setbacks are not an issue. It's the front rear setback, and there are only four out of the 11 that encroach on the setback, and one by only 1 foot, only a 24-foot front setback. So four out of the 11 of the nearest, and according to the ordinance, that does not meet. Meet the requirements of the ordinance. And that's a concern to me, because if our charge is to see if it can meet the requirements and the flexibility as suggested by the ordinance, then I see the front rear is not meeting that, the front and rear only element. We'll call it the front, since it's, we're looking at it from the overlook lane setback issue. This is my opinion, and I certainly don't want to impose my opinions on their design, but it appears to be minimal, and maybe with some creative design work that could be incorporated in the remodel with minimal impact on square footage and visual profile elevation views of the house. And I would tentatively suggest that as a workaround in view of the fact that of its impact in relation to neighboring property.
Thank you.
And I see that as the only issue at this point. I assume that the septic issues and enlargement have all been worked out from that standpoint. Hopefully, this change, or this will be a, this won't affect that at all, I wouldn't think, from the septic design or whatever. I didn't ask where the septic was, but it's not relevant to our discussion.
So Jay, you're suggesting, as you look at the existing house, if we took that back cut, this is the new one, right? If we were to take this concept, instead of raising the roof on this side of the house, just this addition is what you'd suggest that they would consider? Because this is, because what they've done is they've taken the entire second floor, because there's a lot of volume to this house. I mean, this house has got more square footage underground. I mean, it keeps going forever, okay? And I've been through it. And you're suggesting that basically they consider this component in their variance, in their request for variance, not the rest of the house.
Well,
because the original house, if you look at the original design.
Which elevation were you just pointing
at? Well, let's just take the rear elevation. This is the rear of the existing house. This one right here.
Right.
See, it's a block drawing. You're suggesting that they do something on this side, which is over their dining room and living room where the fireplace is, and leave the rest of it alone, essentially.
Let me get to the rear elevation, so I'll be with you just a minute, Jim. East.
I need to caution the board that if you decide to segregate one from the other, and you prove it based on what's submitted, that's what they're obliged to do. So they want to go back to the drawing board, knowing full well that this board would be receptive to a side setback, but not to front and rear, and they want to redesign.
Yeah.
Then they may get a design that fits better than just taking some out. So I mean, you've got to realize that if you do that, they're stuck with that.
So the board could effectively ask the applicant to take this advice and go redesign?
Well, I suggest if what you're proposing doesn't work for them.
Yeah.
But knowing full well that a side setback issue may be that the board would approve something in the side based on the fact that they've met the standards, then I guess that be something that you should probably talk to them about. Yes.
Yeah. I philosophically have, if you're talking about a side and a back, two variances, and the elements met for one of them, then I think we have to be extremely specific on why the elements were not met on the other. I mean, I think it's sort of an all or none, unless the encroachment on one side is going to have a detrimental effect on the neighborhood or some specific, I mean, I think it's sort of a slippery slope. In other words, if we think the criteria has been met on one dimension, then I think we have to be very explicit in what's not being met.
Traditionally, we have looked at side setbacks, comparing side setbacks to side setbacks, because they are a different element of the dwelling than front and rear. Comparing all of the side setbacks of the 10, and in their case 11 nearest properties, they match a majority of the nearest 11 properties as far as side setback encroachment. Front setback encroachment, and I'm calling the back of their house the front, the overlooked lane side encroachment, they do not meet the character of the majority of the character of the existing 11 nearest properties, 10 or 11, either one, nearest existing properties. So that's why I'm looking at it, is because traditionally we have looked at side, compared side to side and front to front. And I believe that traditionally the board has always compared side to side and front to front, and not if they want a front variance and they compile comparative data, we don't allow them to compare side encroachment to front variances. We haven't in the past. I see your point, but my reasoning is this, is we can compare, we can approve the side variance based on comparable properties easily, 8 out of 11. Front, we have a difficult time. 4 out of 11 is not.
But it's the only house, if you drive that knoll, if you listen to the applicant's description of that development, the way it's unfolded up there, it is a very unusual property. It is sort of stuck there in a very different way than anything else up on that road.
And I would, it's, sorry.
I'm sorry. I mean, I just see it as being so one-off, if you will.
And I concur, because if you want, I still think the back is the back and not the front, because if I drive down Trundy Point Road and if I drive up Overlook Drive, first of all, the volume of traffic is much higher on Trundy Point, and I think from a safety point of view, the front of the house is definitely Trundy Point Road. And I think on a dirt road that services just a few homes in the back, and it even comes out in language. To me, that seems to be the back of the house, even though it faces the front of other homes. So, I mean, that's why there's a variance, I guess. It's a very unique situation.
That appears to me to be the hardship as well, and I agree with both of you.
It's a huge hardship in this location.
And you agree what? That
they have done, it is a unique piece of property, and they have done the best that they can with what they've got in terms of the design and it fitting into the neighborhood with minimal impact.
Okay, in view of...
And they've actually improved it a bit, if you think about, not that it matters, but taking that dog fence out and taking that back stairway off the back of the house, it is going to seriously improve what the Kellys look at. It's just, you know, from what I understand of the road. So that is a huge change for the backside of the property. It's really interesting, back, front, side.
Yeah.
But my feeling is that your argument doesn't meet the criteria, and I'm having trouble justifying that. I know it's unique, and I realize that. And it's, the whole house is cattywampus on the lot. I mean, and it's a rolling lot. But I'm having trouble justifying the fact that it does not, the front or rear setback, is not larger or closer to the road or property lines than the average of the nearest 10 properties, and it simply doesn't meet that criteria. Because as Mr. Smith described, it can, in that setback area, it cannot be increased in volume or distance. And either it can or it can't. And if 6 of the nearest 10 do, then it can, and that's my concern, is bending of the ordinance gives us flexibility. It says a majority of the nearest 10 property, of the average, larger than or closer than average of the 10 nearest property. And on the rear setback, it's not abiding by that strict interpretation, strict definition. Yes, please. Yes, if you come to the podium, please, so we can all hear you.
It's so fascinating to hear the process as it unfolds, and I am so respectful of the fact that variances are granted and reviewed on a traditional set of criteria and on precedent. I guess what I invite you to consider is that by using tradition and precedent, you almost exclude my ability to present my case to you, because the house is so very unusual and its circumstances are so very unusual, the odds are that there would be very few, if any, precedents to compare it to. It's almost such a strong anomaly that there is, it's hard to evaluate it according to the traditional means, and that's all I wanted to add, but thank you very much.
Jay, if what you say is, and I have full respect for what you're trying to point out here, if that were the case and we looked at this footprint, is there some direction we should be giving to the applicant to go back and look at the redesign of this second floor, which is effectively over that corner? I mean, that's what seems to be where the hang-up is, that corner. Where the dining room currently exists in this house, that's where the problem is. And if the applicant were to take, I mean, I don't know how the process worked. Do we refer it back? Do they withdraw it? How does it work? But if they redid that piece, they would be fulfilling the criteria.
You're correct. It does not affect the existing structure, right, which would be their
dining
room.
It's the second floor.
It's only the addition above.
Right. I mean, if that wound up being a flat roof, and then you added this bedroom space, which is what you're planning. I mean, I mean we're trying to work and try to be consistent, and I think that's what you're asking the board to be. But I think I look for some guidance as to the direction, because clearly what's in front of us today, if we listen to the chairman's point, there's some concern as to whether we can actually look at this and give it a variance. I'd like to see the applicant look at this and come up with a plan rather than us having us engineer it here.
No, and I have no intention of doing that, and they don't want us to do that, and we do not want to do that. That's not our job. Our job is to review and approve their variance in conforming with the neighborhood, and as simply as that, and that's what I'm trying to do. A breach of the expansion, either up or out, is a breach, whether it's small or large. It would be, and this is the direction of my question earlier for the applicant. What 95% of this variance can be approved, which is the front, left, and right.
Yeah.
It's the rear that's an issue. And if we make concessions for you, then the next applicant will come and say, well, you know, made a concession for them, and they didn't meet the requirement. How can we make it, you know, why can't you do it for us? So it's my feeling that that a breach of the setback, an enlargement in the setback is enlargement in the setback, and it doesn't conform with the nearest 10, then I have trouble viewing that. So my questioning early on to the applicant was, we look at it as a variance, except we are not, and I don't know how to word this, Mr. Smith will advise us on that, but that we eliminate the request for the rear variance from the application and proceed on and look at it as a front left, well, in this case, it's a front left variance.
Yeah.
And eliminate the enlargement, and it's, I'm not an architect, but I would think that that could probably be the second floor. Any volume over and above the existing in that setback area could be configured to hopefully nicely be tailored into the elevation profile left and rear of this, right and rear in this case, of that house. So that would be my suggestion, is that we, with the blessings of Porch Choice of Term, but with the blessing of the applicants, that we eliminate the request for the rear set variation. I want comments of the board, but if we review this from a hard and fast standpoint, that's obvious to me that it doesn't meet the nearest 10 properties. And I think one of the things that's most important to us, and will certainly make ours and future boards' job easier, is that if we're consistent. And that's my concern. And this is an enlargement in the rear setback, and it doesn't meet, there aren't 10 adjacent, the majority of the 10 nearest properties don't have this type of encroachment on the rear setback.
So do we ask the applicant if they're interested in
responding? I would think that would be appropriate.
Well, I'm the lone dissenting member of the board. I'm the odd man out.
No, I don't think you're dissenting at all. I think you point out a valid issue that needs to be considered by this board in what we've done in the past and what we intend to do in the future and what we intend to leave to the next board. So I think it's worth a conversation with the applicant. And I'm speaking for myself. I'd like to hear from the applicant about this issue. Any good architect's going to be able to figure out how to do this right and still offer the same ambiance that's been expressed by you so eloquently about your neighbors and about the cottage style and all those other things. I'd like to hear from you.
And again, I hasten to point out, this doesn't affect your primary, their primary living area, the dining room, or
right,
whatever room is in that corner. It simply affects the enlargement, which is up and above that corner. Please come back to the podium. If you do have any comments, we would appreciate hearing them. But that's, I think you can see the direction that I'm leaning, and that I would have difficulty approving this for that is regardless, that one issue in my mind doesn't meet the ordinance, and it's our goal to make sure that all do and that we're consistent throughout.
So. Mm-hmm. So you're saying you would feel more comfortable taking that
request,
little, that 5 or 6 foot piece out of the expansion of the upstairs?
No, actually they're saying that for us to present this to them and not ask for a variance for that back corner.
Enlargement. According to the ordinance.
Yeah.
That there could be no, you can do whatever you want to over the existing footprint. You just can't increase it in size according to the ordinance.
Square footage. And that's my only clarification.
Second.
You can't increase any square footage. I don't have a problem increasing volume as long as there's no increase in usable space.
Correct. Correct. You understand.
And that was going to be my only question. So, and that's been clarified. So I was going to say, the way you've outlined it makes complete sense. I think it's a very fair compromise. I think that as long as we can work with that corner with installing a roof line where there would be no increase in square footage, we could still maintain the integrity of the design. Might not be exactly what our first choice was, but we'll hope that somebody can come up with a clever second choice.
So the exterior design doesn't change?
Well, no, it would have to, because you couldn't create something, I understand, that could become livable, like, one day, right?
Right, but what I'm getting at is if you have to go back and redesign because of this information, then you probably ought to ask for a table.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
If you can live with the design you got but not increase the square footage, it's because they didn't grant the rear setback variance, then they could approve it.
Well, what I was going to suggest is that we let the design stand in its entirety for the areas you can address, that you feel comfortable addressing, and that that rear corner, we will redesign so that it can be approved within...
Without variance.
Without a variance.
Without a need.
But with the direction of the code enforcement officer issuing a building permit. So in terms of alteration, absolutely nothing would be altered except for that corner with the direction of regular building permit structure.
You're correct.
Does that make sense?
Mr. Smith knows exactly what requires a variance and what is not. What I'm suggesting that the safest direction for you to take at this time is that you withdraw your request for rear variance only. You submit it as everything else as is. You're not requesting a rear variance. You have full liberty to remodel and rebuild within the guidelines established, and Mr. Smith can determine that. There can be no variance issues, which would be the increase in square footage.
Right.
And that's what I'm suggesting.
Yes, let's do that. Can we do that verbally tonight and move forward with it? Awesome.
Am I correct? We can.
So we're saying we could still do the bedroom upstairs.
Yeah.
Just not in the rear.
Yeah, just not that corner, in which
right.
case
you
we'll
can do
everything allow...
Just that corner.
You can't build.
Cannot increase the square footage.
We'll allow a non-livable roof line to...
Also comparable
right.
neighborhood right. situation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Okay. And I hope you fully understand.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that's my request, that you eliminate... Your request was for a front and rear. We eliminate the rear request for variance and proceed.
Okay, that sounds great.
I mean, front.
I'm sorry, side and...
There's two fronts and two rears.
Who's on first?
You're asking.
That's what we'd like to know.
You know...
Front property line variance. And you can just go on and discuss the...
Say again?
Side.
Say again?
You're asking them to eliminate the need for the front property line variance of 10 feet.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yes, that's correct.
Which you're stating is the rear. You're calling the front the rear.
I'm calling the front the front.
Okay. Well,
what's depicted as the rear?
Right. You're talking about the overlook lane side of the house.
Right. Yes.
We're eliminating the need for variance because there will be no increase in the front setback between the dwelling and overlook lane.
Right. Absolutely.
Is that?
That sounds.
We all on the same page.
I think it's a great, Mr. It's a great compromise.
It's frankly. A nice piece of navigating, Mr. Chair.
Say again.
You did that well.
That's a very nice piece of navigating.
Okay. Did you have a comment?
No, it's just semantics.
Yeah, we did. No charge.
You can live with it. Okay.
It's my doodling.
Well, I guess one of my concerns is that we get to. Discuss a 20-foot instead of 25-foot, though, because it is our rear.
It's rear for your purposes of being rear, but for the audience. The audience is tied to anything that's butts the street, whether it be a corner lot or whatever.
Ooh, that's going to be hard,
is a front setback.
That is going to be hard. Boy, I'm going to have to think about that one and look at it again then, because I know it doesn't look like a lot on the piece of paper, but if we're calling that 25 instead of 20, it might make it impossible to find a little space up there. I would have to look at these again.
Bruce, can I ask a point of information?
What is she talking about?
Sure. Technically, can she have two front sidebacks?
Can she have two front setbacks?
Yeah.
Sure.
But she has no rear, this property has no rear.
Not my interpretation, no. I'm trying to find it here.
Isn't this another example, actually, of how my neighbors get to enjoy something I don't, since I had two front setbacks? No?
That is a code enforcement issue, I believe. Not a board issue.
Another interpretation.
Under street, a setback front. I won't read the whole thing, but I'll read the last sentence. A lot having frontage on more than one street, which it does have frontage on more than one street, shall be required to meet the minimum front setback on each street.
I have rearage on one of the streets.
Now, if you apply the same criteria, just to play devil's advocate, and if you were to summate the front and rear setbacks, or in this case, the front and front setbacks, it's not out of line with anything in that neighborhood. In other words, if you would add the front back to the front and rear of the 10 most adjacent houses and divide by 2, there's very little difference between any of these houses.
I don't know where you're getting that information from. But.
Well, from data comparison table. If we look at the existing front and rear setbacks, it's just to make another column.
Right.
In other words, it's just basically where the location of this house is in this particular lot. And it seems like there's a double whammy because this is being interpreted from it having two front setbacks. And I guess my question is, there's nothing in the ordinance that because it's not in reference to the type of road that it's on, which determines whether it's front or not. In other words, a secondary unpaved road has the same weight as a major connector.
Is Overlook Lane a private way?
Yes. But it fits the definition of street.
It what?
The street is a public or private way. That's has a gravel surface that's used on a regular basis for vehicles.
So it's still considered a public street, even if it's a graveled private way.
Right.
Early on, at the very beginning, I pointed out the on this drawing, the front left and right being 25 and the rear being 20, and you said that didn't apply in this situation or wasn't relevant in this situation.
Well, it's not relevant to what you have to compare it to be eligible for variance. Whether the setback is 20 feet or 50 feet, if you've got the majority of the neighbors that are as close or that are non-conforming to that setback, then you meet the standard.
Well,
regardless of what the setback
is. Just for reference, when I lumped the front and rear setbacks, I included anything less than 25 feet. I didn't look just at 20 feet. I looked at 25, and 4 of the 11 or 4 of the 10, either way, less than half,
yeah.
Right.
met that. Now, how does this discussion impact the applicants? Talking about 20 versus 25 feet.
I see her point. I see, It cuts it back quite a ways.
Yeah. It cuts it back quite a ways. I will be put in a position where there's no point in me asking because of how much of the existing foundation of the house is affected. I won't be able to have my other neighbors have in terms of square footage. It will be an economic hardship to me. This is just my best guess.
Okay, well, let me show you. I've already measured it, and it's actually, let me get the 1-inch line. This is just for reference. This is 20 feet here, see, 0.2.
Right.
So, and this is 25, which was this point
right.
here,
right.
two and a half, three. So the 25 comes right at this intersection, right here.
Oh, you know what?
Right here.
Yeah, it should be
You see that?
It should be 2.5 inches total, is that beginning?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah, and on an inch, it's, it is, it's exactly 2.5. Where the rear set, rear dwelling matches the side setback. So let me, well, I'll parallel this line. And this will be the, yes, now you can go.
So, it does come back in.
So if you, if you show that kindly to.
Yes. What's going to happen is it's going to affect this portion of the design too, because now it's into this rectangle of the house.
And again, this only affects the upstairs. Does not affect in any way existing square footage, existing floor plan of the ground floor.
Right.
It only affects the addition.
Yes, but the intention of the addition is to get needed livable space, and this is so bisecting that space. I'm not sure that there's a way to both aesthetically and practically gain that space.
Wouldn't you be back here? Right to the, right to this point? From this corner?
This is the setback line. I was just drawing the peak of the roof line bisecting through the half of that, just to see where that goes.
If you go over the overhang with the roof line, take the overhang in.
It's going to make the house really aesthetically lopsided. It's you know, one of the things we did, just for your point of reference, is we hired an architect.
If you would, if...
Oh, sorry, sorry. I will.
We just want the audience at home to have the benefit of your comments.
We hired an architect and spent, lost 6 or 7 months of time because it didn't go in a... favorable direction, and it actually ended up costing us thousands of dollars to cut our losses and move on. But we're so committed to becoming part of that neighborhood, part of that cluster. I think that those types of clusters are very, very rare in Maine. They're dwindling, they're getting gentrified and outscaled, and we really want to respect it. And this architect went in such a different direction for us that we said thanks, but no thanks, we'll move on. So just to give you an example of what happened, it's really hard. We've done 12 times the developers who are doing now. I mean, this was just so horrible to us. We said, it's not going to work for what we want that house to be. And we've gone through so many designs trying to provide what we need, but also you know,
well,
be respectful of our property values and others. I mean, that's what it boils down to, also, right? And find the size that we need.
I don't want you, I know you're discouraged. That's not our intention, but...
It is discouraging because I did check 3 different times about the setbacks. I twice and my contractor once.
Whether it's 20 or 25 feet, it doesn't meet the rear setback.
Right, but with 20 feet...
In comparison to your neighbors.
Right, but with 20 feet, it's workable aesthetically. With 20 feet, 25 feet, I have serious doubts that there's going to be a solution. I truly do. And I'm an artist and I'm a designer myself. And so I say that not as a layperson, but from a lot of experience. That does truly concern me. And I do think that we have an obligation to the neighbors in the neighborhood, to their property values, to fit in with the neighborhood. And I almost think it's unfair to be held to the criteria of how things have been done before, because this kind of house is so rare, it hasn't been explored before, this kind of situation. So how can there be a criteria that allows you to line it up
with tradition.
Mr. Smith, based on your, where did you read that earlier regarding the viewing the front and the rear as one and the same? Was that in the definition?
It's under district regulations. My, you know, in defense to my staff do not make, they will not make a call on setbacks for any particular lot.
Say again?
My staff will not make a determination on setbacks for any particular lot. They will guide the, somebody comes in the office to, here's the section, but that's really as far as they go. You know, the question, they always refer those questions to me, so I don't know how that happened.
All I know is that when I made an offer on the house, I called you and got, and you told me the setbacks, and I wrote them down, and I have the record of that, and I don't mean, it seems like it's just a glitch in the whole process. I'm just trying to not point blame in any way, shape, or form, because things evolve the way they do for, you know, that's okay that, you know, I don't expect everything to be perfect all the time. I'm just trying to explain how we are here today and how I'm at a point of confusion and like you correctly mentioned, frustration now, because I would love to be able to work with the building code, but I'm concerned that it will be a house that aesthetically doesn't support its own property value for me, for the neighbors who are adjacent to it. Both those choices are seriously dangerous, and with complying with two front setback requirements instead of being allowed a rear, I'm at serious risk of not being able to find additional square footage inside the house. And I think it's a fairly modest expansion. I haven't gone, you know, overboard in trying to create excessive space and to so diminish it.
Well, see, if you specifically asked what your rear setback was, the answer would have been 20 feet.
Yeah, right. And I'm sure that in good faith, yeah. So, but the thing is, if it's more to that than that. Yeah, if it's,
you know,
I understand completely. I understand. I'm just trying to explain the evolution of it. And so where does that leave us in a place where we can create effective change?
The way I see it is we have three options. One is that you eliminate the request for the rear setback with the obvious impact that that has on your design.
Mm-hmm.
You continue with your application as is with my concerns, which in my mind are valid. And it has nothing to do with your desires or your needs or the property. It has to do with the ordinance. And I'm purely trying to interpret the ordinance as best and consistently and uniformly as I can for everybody. And
I understand, but isn't the main aspect of the ordinance, isn't the main aspect is not to do significant economic injury to any particular party?
That's correct, and that's why.
So, I mean, and can we speak to the letter of that as much as we can in this particular regard, I guess would be my request.
Well, it's the undesirable change in the neighborhood. If none of the other houses are that close, then two-story houses close to the property line, then if less than half of your neighbors are that way, then that becomes an impact on the majority who don't have enlargement in the setback. And so that's the issue. It's not economic feature.
But it is.
It's part of the practical difficulty standards. You have to show to the board that you would suffer significant economic loss. And the same thing applies there, that you have to show this data, or the applicant has to show this data to the board to show that without the variance, they'd be deprived of something that already exists in the neighborhood as to size and location. And that's also the reason for this chart. Because if the rest of the neighborhood doesn't already have something that you want,
mm-hmm.
then you're not being deprived of something that mm-hmm. already exists.
Mm-hmm. But they do have two-story houses.
You see my point.
Yes, but they do have two and three-story houses.
Much more eloquently than I did.
Yeah, but they do have two and three-story houses with greater square footage than we do. They just happen to have topography that allowed them placements that present their own specific type of setback anomalies. Some of them are, it's going to be, they're pushed into one corner, some of them are going to be pushed to one side, some are going to be pushed to the front. And it's all because of topography, so we're all doing the exact same thing in exact same way. Regardless of what the setback requirements are, we're finding the position of topography that allows the placement of a house. And it's just coincidence that some of that happens to fall within setback requirements on some sides of some of the houses. So what I'm asking you to consider is that the topography precludes other placement of the house or expansion for me, that the other neighbors do have something that we don't have. And it would cause injury not to be able to expand in a like manner and like style.
I certainly see your point. The ordinance only allows us to go so far in dealing with these inherent variables in each unique property. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're faced with. And it
right.
has nothing to do with your design. So your options are to withdraw your application, reconfigure the rear to, well, the rear is always going to be an issue because of the comparable properties, the comps, your neighborhood comps. That will always be an issue. Withdraw the application. See if you can make it work without a rear variation. That's what I was getting at when I say withdraw from tonight. See if you can come up with a plan. It could be that rear corner turns into an open deck.
I was under the impression that we couldn't do that.
So
and also it would be such a lot.
We can't increase the living space, correct?
You can't prove any square footage, additional square footage, whether it be decked or whatever.
So a deck would be increased.
And remember, it looks small to you on that, but you're looking at something that's like, I mean, you're going to have to architecturally, you can't just carve out a triangle. You have to carve out the whole rectangle. So you're carving out an area that's probably 12 by 26.
Yeah.
It's quite significant that you can't work with because of the angle. So you're not just eliminating that triangle. You're in effect not allowing architectural adjustment to a whole rectangle.
The way I see it is that you with either,
oops.
If you withdraw your rear request for variance, then and the side in front is approved, then there's no obligation to continue and build on your part.
Right.
I mean, we would certainly hope you would, and we'd certainly hope this wouldn't deter you from. You know, redesign and regroup and redesign, but to be approved, there's no obligation. So that's the way I see it at this point. And it's not based on anything else except you have less than half of your neighboring encroach on either the front or the rear setback. And that's when we have to, our hands, in my mind, our hands are tied, we have to look at that issue, and that is one of the elements, and in my mind, that's a stumbling block. Whether it's right or wrong, whether it makes sense, whether it's stupid, it just doesn't meet the guidelines given to us by the ordinance, and that is my concern.
Could I just, since that's our crossroads, could I respectfully request that we read that part of the ordinance so that I'm sure I understand it?
If we do what?
Could we read aloud from the text of the ordinance, please? So
you,
that I'm sure
you want
that
to read it?
Yeah, is that possible, since it's our crossroads for the discussion? And we have to determine whether to drop that part out. Could we read the ordinance aloud?
Now?
Yeah.
Oh.
Aloud for all our benefits, so that I'm sure that I completely understand the nature of the requirements of the ordinance.
Mr. Smith?
Is that a possibility?
What section are we talking about?
Are you talking about undesirable change in the neighborhood?
Pardon me?
The undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood?
Whichever part of the ordinance you're referring to that we don't meet, I was just wondering if we could read it out loud.
This is what I read earlier. Item number four, element number four in the variance process is, the granting of the variance will not produce an undesirable, and this is a significant phrase, an undesirable change in the character of the neighbor. Let me read again. Item number four, the granting of the variance will not produce an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood and will not unreasonably detrimentally affect the use or market value of abutting properties. The clause, undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood, is clearly defined under the definitions of the ordinance. In the very beginning is a section entitled definitions, I believe. Could be, not sure.
Yes.
Just a definition. Undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood. The result of a variance where the structure is larger, which is your case, or closer to the road or property lines than the average of the nearest 10 principal structures, or in the case of a variance request for an accessory structure, the nearest 10 accessory structures. And that was written, there's a note there, effective August 10th of the year 2000. So this is in August of 2000. This was updated to some degree, and I'm not sure.
Thank you. I appreciate it very much.
Second half of that is the practical difficulty that you have to show. It's an occasion where the strict application of the ordinance to a property precludes the ability of the property owner to pursue a use permitted in the zoning district in which the property is located and results in significant economic loss. You go to significant economic loss, it's placing the applicant for a variance a disadvantage in the neighborhood by applying zoning ordinance standards which would prevent the applicant from having a structure comparable in size, location, and number to those of other lot owners in the immediate neighborhood, but in no case 10. So you got two places that comparison has to come into play.
Thank you. It's helpful to hear it. I guess the part that becomes hard is that specific character of that hillside where the close placement of structures to a road aren't a detriment to the neighborhood, as is referred to in that discussion, but they're actually a contributing factor of the ambiance or charm of that cluster. So it becomes a neighborhood that almost doesn't fit the criteria as we think of it as a livable neighborhood, and that clustering is a contributor. It's not a harmful. I'm not sure if I am. So it's almost like the criteria for the variance can almost not be applied to this hillside, because that's what's so charming about it, is the way the houses are placed right on the road and right close to each other.
Well, the hillside is not the issue. It's the proximity to the roadway.
Right, but. Well, I'm not sure if you had a chance to visit it up there or not, but that's kind of life up there, the proximity to the roadway. It's
no, and I fully appreciate your concern.
Go ahead. Yeah. I don't know what to say. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, the way I'm thinking is if the rear setback issue is a deciding factor in you making this decision, then we're in a situation where none of the addition makes sense at all from an architectural standpoint or from a standpoint of benefiting that neighborhood. Architecturally, it would be unlike anything up there, and it would be a great loss, I think, to us and the neighborhood. The neighbors very, very warmly received the architecture of this home and said it would be a huge improvement of what it is. I don't know how you weight each criteria in your ordinance. I would hope that you could weight each in respect to how it is a favorable addition. But in my mind, I guess it's, if it is declined by the board, I don't know if there's, I don't see anything possible that we could do to get the extra square footage that we're looking for.
How's the foundation? How's the foundation? Is it in good shape?
Foundation's in good shape, yeah.
So there wouldn't be a possibility to pick it up and move it back so that you didn't have that issue on them?
Oh, it wouldn't be possible because of the hillside? I mean, it's like sitting in the only.
It's pretty steep. It's very steep in front. The 20 feet or the 15 feet or whatever it is to overlook is flat. But that's the flattest point. It's very steep in the front of the home. I don't know how you could.
I don't know how you could either.
How you could do it. If you could do it, it'd be great. But it's very steep there.
I know.
The board's often put in a position where they look at a plan and they say, geez, this is great, you know? This is going to be an asset. But unfortunately, if you have standards, you got to go by the standards. Otherwise, there's no sense to have criteria. You know, you might as well just change the setbacks if you're going to just approve it, you know? And, I mean, that's the tough position the board's in.
It is a tough position, yeah.
I don't know what to say. We've tried so many. Because one of the things we did before going this route was try to work within the code without a variance, the building code. And boy, we put a lot of plans on the drawing board. We're really not here today because we think we want what we want, kind of this design. It's because we tried so many other ones and couldn't keep the house as well proportioned, as well balanced, and as aesthetically a contributor to the environment that it was in, which of course is so important to our property value. I mean, my feeling is that I'm making a wise choice as a property owner to pick a timeless style of architecture that has stood the test of time, tried and true, and holds its value as opposed to a fad in architecture. And that's my commitment. And proportion is very important in antique architecture. It's going to be very hard to... I don't know.
Would you like to withdraw and regroup? Or would you like to eliminate the rear variance, or would you like to keep it as it is?
I guess.
And submit it for vote.
What do you want to do? I mean, obviously, the board strongly feels we don't meet the criteria for rear.
Probably withdraw at this point.
Withdraw the rear and go for the other two and see if there's anything we can do. I don't know if we can. I mean, I really think we're going to be in a position where we're just going to fix the house back up and sell it.
Right.
Because it's not going to meet our needs.
Yeah.
It's what?
I think we will be put in a position where we have to put the house back to rights and sell it because it will not meet our needs. And this is what I did try to avoid when I made phone calls. In the purchasing process of it. But we could eliminate that rear and give it our best shot with sincerity, knowing that we have the plan B of selling it if we have to. I don't know what else to say.
If you withdraw it and take it back to your architect now and rethink your process, I mean, they can get on the agenda for October, can't they? I mean, it seems to me that...
And your variance is good for a year before you have to take action.
Yeah, I think...
Yeah, the problem is that, you know, I can't even impress upon you enough how strong our commitment has been to keeping the aesthetic vision of this, to keep the house not just well-proportioned in itself, but well-proportioned on the lot in that placement. We lost so much time that our houses are sold. We have no place to go.
But the point is that the direction that you've gotten, at least in the council or advice, whatever, from us,
right,
has that been given to an architect, designer, for solutions? I mean, you sound like you've got lots
yeah.
of ideas, and I applaud that effort, because I think it's good for you,
right.
It's good for the community, but I think you now have some direction that you go back to the professionals and throw it at them and say, here's what we have, let's do all the things we want, cottage
right.
style, consistent with neighborhood, all those kinds of issues. It just seems to me, I would err on the side of more time with a professional
yeah.
prior to getting a decision out of us. Because
are you suggesting then that they withdraw their application?
I would strongly recommend
and you're thinking along the line that if we approve the side setback as is, then that's what they have to deal with? Or are you thinking along the line that the side setback would be reconfigured?
Well, I think they could accept the whole premise that we've laid out better if they had a professional tell them exactly what this 25 feet is going to do to the second floor addition.
For the rear.
Proposed, in the rear, right?
And I don't think the applicant is obligated to identify why they're withdrawing. They can come back
and
say...
No,
but I think you have to be careful. If you withdraw, you know, the process starts all over again.
Yeah.
Completely.
You know what? Thank you for all your suggestions. I mean, I don't mean to appear anything but cooperative. I think that our best choice was outlined by the chairman earlier, which is to retract the request, withdraw the request for the rear/front, whatever we want to call it tonight, variance. Let's move forward, if we may, with the other aspects and assume positive outcome working with a professional as the best case scenario for dealing with that back of the house. Does that make sense?
To me, that is a proper approach.
Yeah.
Continue with
yeah.
the side,
continue
yeah,
with
the front. If it works, you can make it work. If it doesn't, then
we'll cross that bridge when we come to it.
As need be.
Exactly. Exactly. That's the best use of all of our time here, I think.
I wouldn't give up
yeah.
on the design
yeah.
until you've had a professional say, you know, and I can come up with this. And they are incredibly creative, as you know.
Yeah.
That's the line that I would proceed in, was withdraw the request for the rear variance and carry up.
Right.
Yeah.
And see what you can come up with.
Let's go for it.
Haven't lost anything any more than what you have now. In my mind, if a rear variance doesn't work today, it's not going to work in October either.
Exactly. Exactly. Exactly.
Do we need a variance for the side, or do we need to?
Yes, we do.
You do.
Proceed without this evening?
You are enlarging the side. You are going up, you're adding a second floor on the side.
So we need
now, why does the side work? Because 8 out of 11
gotcha.
Has the same issue.
Right. Okay.
And I don't want to...
Here goes Mr. Smith.
I don't want to drag this out, but my statement stands earlier that if they withdraw that part and the other part gets approved, it's based on what's submitted here. So you can't go back to the drawing board and come back with something else that's gonna allow square footage different than how it's laid out here. And if that's the case, then that's fine. If it isn't, they're better off to table it.
That was your
back with another plan.
That was your point.
And then they know they have a direction that you're gonna, the side setbacks are not an issue.
It would be to your best interest to just see.
No, I understand exactly what you're saying, and the part of the design would hold. I don't see any alteration in that volume or square footage wise, because what we're discussing is we're discussing gaining space over, unless you want me to throw in like a really fast dormer.
Here's your point.
No, because you know, sometimes it the simplest is the best, and the Cape Cod style of roof line, I mean, if you guys want, I can tell you, so throw in the dormer on the side.
We come to the...
Need a suggestion.
This is the man that needs to rule on your really fast dormer here.
Oh, really?
Well, I mean, because his point is, whatever you submit, evidently, and this is beyond our jurisdiction, what you submit is what he's going to allow you to build.
That's on what side?
It's on the side variance side we're discussing.
So that's an increase in the square footage over what you proposed tonight?
No, it's going to be, actually, the square footage will still be a lot less because...
No, I'm talking about the square footage for the side setback.
It will be, unless you let me draw this in right now.
I think the more proper thing would be to decide whether we'll table it or hold for later. Mr. Chair?
If proposing something for the side setback, it's going to increase square footage from what we had tonight. And that's why you should table it.
Okay.
Table it.
Okay, I try.
Well, you bring that.
May I make a suggestion? It's my understanding that, hate to make, I think everyone wants to get into the same resolution, and we're trying to put a square into a round hole. And I think there is a way to do that, but I think at this point of the day, it might not end up being to your benefit. Maybe the thing to do, and my understanding is, if we withdraw your application, then the application is essentially dead, and you have to go through the whole application process again. It's my understanding that if we table this application to the next meeting, it sort of just puts everything in suspended animation, gives you some breathing time to reconfigure. We could bring the same application back with amendments if it's tabled at the next meeting. And I think that would be give you the most freedom to try and make this work out.
I think I'm hearing that you don't want to. You don't want that much time.
I guess I am concerned about losing a month. I mean, the winter of trying to raise that roof line and find a place to live for a couple months. Anybody got a house to rent for 3 or 4 months? It's getting very complicated and problematic, and we lost so much time because of getting to the place where we knew we had to shift gears with the architect, which is unfortunate.
My concern is, for example, what I'm hearing is that we take away the rear variance and just talk about the side variance, and then the plans as is go in, and then your architect, when he's trying to figure out how to dummy up that space in the corner or whatever, there is some critical change, then the whole thing is not, because it's not part of what was approved. And then you're set back once again in the same situation with them in terms of time, so.
And just one final question, because that I'm really appreciating, that makes a lot of sense. If we have to make major changes in what I'm going to call the right rectangle of the house, major cutbacks, maybe we have to make changes in the left rectangle. So is there any way at all to apply the 20-foot setback to the rear of my house at all? There's no way to revisit that setback.
That's what the ordinance says, you know. I can't deviate from the ordinance. The ordinance, no can the board. There's no way to do that. A lot having frontage on more than one street shall be required to meet the minimum front setback on each street. There's no room to interpret anything other than that.
Right. Except that word frontage sure makes it sound like it's the front.
Well, unfortunately, the ordinance is very clear in that.
I think we have to take Mike's suggestion as the best one and table it.
How about we just plant grass on Overlook Lane and not call it a road anymore?
Neighbor got to do, which is another thing. I mean, that's the whole craziness of Overlook Lane. The way you see it on the tax map, it doesn't even exist like that anymore because the neighbor did grass it over.
Well, I think some of that is discontinued. Legally discontinued.
Yes, it is. Yes.
Well, it's not on the tax records yet. They're still all separate lots, and they don't include the road.
He's talking about the road.
But tax records.
He's talking about the road.
I think it all comes back to tabling it for this evening.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
I guess we'll need to table it for a month.
Yeah. I mean, what else can we do? Yeah, makes sense, because this is a major change.
I know it's a major disappointment to you, but I hope you see our concerns and our points and our issues that we're faced with. And I also hope that you see we're working as hard as we can to make this work. And we, it's within the ordinance. I mean, it's not our goal to make it work for you, it's our goal to interpret the ordinance, and...
We respect that.
We do, and you've been very thorough, all of you. I mean, I really feel like tonight we identified other potential pitfalls and roadblocks that we could have stumbled into accidentally, which it was really better that we explored it as thoroughly as we did, and we really appreciate that.
So we can come back a month from now, when you say table, that means come back with new plans that meet the setbacks and so on.
Correct. Mr. Smith, if they table, they can come back with amended plans, correct?
Sure.
Next month.
You, as long as they're not asking for a variance that deviates from what's already been advertised.
Right.
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 So what do we need to do for you, and what type of timing then, in order to accomplish this? Do we just show up with 10 copies of the plans? Do we get 10 plans to your office before?
We send the packets out the week before. If you've got something that they can look at, it's much better than bringing it to the meeting.
Yeah.
A week before the meeting.
Right.
Yeah.
2 weeks.
Okay.
And do I need to do any other additional paperwork to accommodate getting on that agenda, or?
We are on the agenda. They're going to...
Awesome.
You'll be on the agenda, and you can look to the code officer for any, you know, additional work that you need. But from our standpoint, that's all we need.
Okay.
And he'll be at your service to answer those type of questions and for you. And I'm sure he'll make sure you have all the appropriate, if any, additional information you need.
Mm-hmm. That's all.
Primarily, it's revised plans. That work.
Yeah.
Aesthetically, cosmetically, make sense within the guidelines that we're faced to impose.
Yeah.
And which would be eliminate the request for the rear variance, so there'd be no increase in square footage or up or out in the rear because of comparable property. So we'll table that issue with your...
Wow. You guys are really, really devoted and dedicated to miss so much baseball for us. Thank you so much.
Thank you both. It was well done.
Oh, you know what? I have one quick question. The problem is that how do we come back to you with additional plans if this triangle just cut into what we were asking for about the side?
Well, that didn't affect the side, I don't believe.
It doesn't, but see how there's this rectangle of the house and this rectangle of the house? Architecturally, you're going to have to work with one or the other, and now the rear setback creates a corner into...
I don't know that we can speak to it. Perhaps an architect, knowing what you've encountered tonight...
Yeah.
I would think and hope that he could be creative with that. I'd...
Okay. I just hope that we can meet your requirements, but that's my only concern. Okay, so that comes here, not side of the rear. We can stay out of there.
Say again?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Do you need a motion?
Motion.
Mr. Chairman.
Motion.
Do we need a motion?
Yes.
I'll make a motion. To a table.
Thank you.
Seconded.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All those in favor? All in favor, none opposed. Next item on the agenda is communications. There are a couple. Three board members are term expires at the end of this year. And that would be Gib Mendelson, Steve LaPlante, and Joe Guglielmetti. of those three, Steve LaPlante unfortunately must decline.
Yes, that is correct. We'll be declining it.
Next, a third term due to business obligations. Joe Guglielmetti accepts with reservations in view of the fact that he has increasing business obligations, and Gib Mendelson accepts without reservation. One of the issues that the town council is doing is, and they have done this for, I don't know how long, but for some time, they've been interviewing applicants and re-applicants, reappointees, and getting their opinions and their attendance record and seeing how that does come into to play as far as the number of meetings that they've been able to attend. This is an all-volunteer service, of course, but attendance is important, and the town council recognizes that, and they are looking at that critically, and I think that's to the for all boards and commissions, so that is, I think, in our favor. For the record and for the viewers at home, there is, I believe, the 1st of October, the town clerk stated that there would be an application, if not already, on the town website describing the duties and the application process. And the application has to be in sometime in October, I believe. So with that in mind, the second thing that I wanted to point out is that I received a communication, a memo from the Maine Municipal Association regarding a basic workshop for local planning boards and boards of appeal in Augusta in November. If anyone's interested in that, I have information on that, as does the, I'm sure, the code office. And the last item.
Is that free?
I would think it would be.
There's a line for billing address and $35 per person fee.
Is that in the budget, Bruce?
If anybody wants to go, check to see if the town.
What's the date?
I would assume the town would put that.
The date is November 29 from 6 to 8:30 p.m. in the Augusta Civic Center. Fee $35 per person includes packet material and hot buffet.
Ooh, hot buffet.
5:30 to 6.
Have you been to that one? I haven't been to the Maine Municipal one, no.
You think someone from the board should go? And
it certainly doesn't help to. Doesn't hurt to have to have refresher courses. They put on a good course, I'm sure.
Well, I'll look at my schedule. I'd be interested on, you know, and then report to the board the results.
There's a whole list of topics there.
I'll check with the town manager to see if there's money's available from the town coffers.
I'd like to hope there would be for that.
I would assume that. But I'm not sure.
It's not a significant amount fee-wise, but I would hope that there would be. And the last issue in discussion with Mr. Smith, and I'd like comments from the other board members that are attending. We, in an effort to more easily confirm what board members are going to be able to attend each meeting, and those that are not going to be able to attend, we would like to suggest to have all board members call the code office either when you receive your packets or the week before the meeting, which in this case would be last week, for example, declaring your ability to attend or not attend. Does anyone have
call or email? That was rather embarrassing for the town last month. And it was almost as embarrassing this month. And I know it's volunteer and people have issues. But if we know ahead of time, we won't be put in a position, precarious position, most of the time. Mm-hmm. I mean, this was couldn't have done much about this, because the person, you know, Gibb had some problems at home, so, you know, you can't really blame anybody, but...
But just for a point of information, and to set the record completely straight, for my tenure on this board, I've usually received materials well in advance, and I did not receive any materials at all until late on Monday night. It was after...
This week?
Nope, for the preceding...
Well, that was directly related to the police not getting the packets out, and they should have.
And, you know, I didn't know it was on the agenda. I did not have time to read the packet within 12 hours and go to work that day, my first responsibility, nor did I know where the property was to take a look at. So if the information can't be distributed, I think I knew what happened, but it wasn't like, oh, gee, we decided not to come to the meeting. At that particular point in time, the meeting, by definition, had been canceled by...
I understand that. But when, if the meeting's canceled, if you notice, you always get a... If you don't get a packet, you always get a notice saying there's no meeting. So it was unfortunate what happened last month.
Yep.
And I didn't know that the packets weren't delivered until Monday.
Yeah, I mean, it was... It's ugly, as you referred to, but it was sort of...
It was unfortunate,
yeah.
But we've had close calls before, though, and I guess this just shows, you know, I understand, I appreciate what you're saying, but it would make it easier if everybody could just say, yeah, we're going to come, and that way we don't have to, when we get a couple calls, we don't have to worry and start scurrying to see if we can get enough members together. So, you know, if we could do that, I mean, it would be helpful.
This request is not at all based on last week. I mean, over my tenure on the board, there have been meetings where we were unsure who was going to attend, and I think it's simply in the board's and the code officer's benefit to know in advance exactly who's going to be able to attend and not. And that's simply all we're suggesting, is that in advance, some days in advance, we notify the secretary that we're going to be able to attend or not.
Yeah, in the interest of preaching to the choir, I would ask that the chairman or Bruce, someone, have this conversation with the rest of the board in person, as opposed to just simply in the minutes.
I agree.
I just think it's, you know, we're here, and I think it's important to be in record, but I also believe that each one of the board members needs to hear it.
And I agree fully.
I just think it's embarrassing to a board member not to be able to handle the business at hand.
Right.
And we're citizens who wish to work with citizens to make this a better place to live. And the fact that this didn't happen tonight is so unfortunate for that couple.
Well, it is. And this tonight was due to a medical emergency that couldn't have been foreseen.
Which is a shame.
So we do need to...
Well, and if
the boards ever have...
Steve LaPlante didn't have friends, I mean, he could have...
Yeah, there you go.
I've tried not being nice, Bruce. I just can't do it.
Yeah. Do boards ever have alternates? An alternate?
Well, I discussed that with Mike McGovern about alternates. Because we haven't had, because we've got a seven-member board.
Yeah.
A lot of towns have a five-member board with two alternates.
Yeah.
But we did discuss that today, and we probably will discuss it further, having one or two alternates.
Yeah.
To fill in, but generally speaking, we don't have a problem.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it just seems like lately it's been working.
But you're going to run into a lot of what Steve runs into. I mean, when you have seven of us who are from various parts of the town, the eventuality of having somebody that we know presenting something to us is going to happen. So if you ever had, the ability to have an alternate.
But it's a fairly large board with seven members and everyone in attendance. It wouldn't have been an issue.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
It just happened. It just didn't work out.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah.
But it's hard to explain to the
citizen
who was, you know, needs to get going because of winter. So.
And it's a legitimate concern.
But hopefully that won't be a major impact on any board member. Just to simply call in and if you're in the business
Call or email. You can shoot us off an email.
Yeah.
Or an email. either one, just to accept or decline, confirm or not. Of attendance.
The use of the police department worries my wife when she sees the police officer drive up the road, and also my neighbors seem to have fun with it as well. So I don't know whether there's a better alternative. I know I don't want to spend town monies.
We don't normally send it out unless it's a package bulky.
Yeah.
I mean, we don't usually use the police unless the package bulky.
Yeah.
We normally send it through the mail if we can.
Yeah.
But the planning board sends all their packets by the police department.
Really?
So, yeah. If we're getting into a bunch of postage, $4, $5, $6 a piece, you know, it's not a big deal, but we try to keep the cost down. But if you prefer not have the police to come to your, we can probably do something for you.
Maybe the EMTs would like to do it.
Any other items? May I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Seconded.
All in favor?